So I'm here with Katy Bourne, Police and Crime Commissioner for Sussex, for this episode of The Vote. Welcome back, Katy. Last time we spoke, it was via Zoom, wasn't it, I think?
I think it was, yes. So it's nice to see you in person.
Nice to be back socially distanced in the studio. Yeah. Start off with a new Chief Constable. Tell us all about it. It's Jo Shiner, isn't it? And is it the first female Chief Constable for Sussex?
You've stolen my thunder. Yes, yeah. She is. First female Chief Constable substantive that we've ever had. So really good news for Sussex, and she's hit the ground running. So she started back in June, and she's quite clear around, you know, where she sees the force going. What I think really impressed me with her in the interview was her passion for Sussex and the fact that she understands the importance of listening to people and giving, you know, all our communities, because they're quite diverse across the county, giving them all opportunity for their voices to be heard and literally understanding what it means to them. So, yeah, very exciting times.
Yeah, and what are going to be her priorities? Because we had a kind of small dip in crime, didn't we, during the COVID outbreak with certain crimes, anyway, burglary, for example, but there's been an uptick on fraud, for example, domestic abuse, I think child abuse as well.
Yep, you're very well briefed. So crime is now back to the levels it was before we went into lockdown, so pre-COVID.
Yeah.
But certainly, I mean, I don't want to you know, put words into her mouth of what her priorities are, but certainly she's driven by the police and crime plan that I write on behalf of the public. And there are areas that we are going to continue focusing on. So one of them is strengthening local policing. We're going to continue with the recruitment programme. So the government are obviously giving us money to recruit extra officers, but local taxpayers are paying a bit more as well because they wanted more bobbies on the beat. And that's absolutely what she's going to continue doing. And then there's other areas that we're going to focus on. So some of our rural areas, we now have a dedicated rural crime team. So really pushing that forwards, looking at business crime as well, business and retail crime, and some of the violence against shop workers and that we've seen, particularly during the pandemic, but continuing since. So there are some clear areas, and roads policing is another area.
Yeah, exactly. There was an uptick in speed crime, wasn't it, I think, that people probably thought they weren't going to get caught.
Yeah, it was really surprising. I was talking to a roads policing officer just last week, and he said, you know, people thought that during lockdown, actually, there'd be less accidents because there was less traffic on the roads. It wasn't the case. There was still the same number of accidents that we're seeing, and people were driving faster, and they've continued to drive faster. So there's a lot of effort at the moment going on in the force around enforcing, you know, speed limits and making sure that cars aren't driving recklessly, any antisocial behaviour and that. So there will be a focus on that in the weeks and months ahead.
Yeah. And what's your role with Sussex Police? It'd be good to just outline what what role you have with Sussex.
Well, I'm elected by the residents of Sussex. So there's 1.7 million people living in Sussex. So it's a pretty big constituency to have. And I'm here for 4 years. And my job is to set the strategic direction of Sussex Police. And I do that by writing a plan, police and crime plan. And it must reflect what local people tell me matters to them. So things like, you know, having that visibility of policing in our communities, having extra officers, tackling the roads, tackling the rural areas. These are all issues that are important to people in Sussex, and so they're reflected in our police and crime plan. And then I set the budget. I can raise local council tax to pay for policing. That's my decision. And ultimately, I can appoint and, if necessary, dismiss the chief constable. So, pretty wide-ranging role, really.
Exactly. Going back to the crime aspect then, sure. I mean, I guess people are a bit worried about, you know, the increase in, as you say, fraud. I mean, is it more of a priority now that this online fraud, and particularly amongst the older population who, you know, might be more susceptible to being a victim?
Frauds are fastest growing crime type, and a lot of it's moved online. You're absolutely right. I mean, why burgle someone's house when you can reach through the internet and grab the money off their credit card or through their bank account much more efficiently and quickly and easily? So, yes, online fraud is an issue. But, you know, it's interesting now because the policing model is having to change as well because crime types are changing. Where we like to see that visible policing in the neighbourhood, so we like to see our police walk that physical beat, they also need to walk a digital beat as well. So they need to keep us safe online. And we've seen, particularly in lockdown, an increase in child abuse online. So the sharing of indecent child images has been pretty horrific during lockdown. I mean, that's gone up 10% more than we normally see. The National Crime Agency released some really worrying figures recently that said that at any one time in the UK, there are 300,000 potential predators online who are sharing indecent images of children. That's more than double the number we knew about last year.
Yeah.
So this is a really worrying area. And how do the police, you know, every day keep us safe in both the physical and the digital? It's an interesting conundrum.
It is, and they're going to have more resources, aren't they, the police? Yeah. And I know they've had more resources in county lines, tackling county lines, drug mm-hmm. lines. So just tell us a bit about what happened over the lockdown, because I know that particularly the Met Police were kind of driving forward, you know, the response against the county line drugs. It caused a lot of harm, don't it? Particularly in Brighton, we're kind of a bit of a hot spot for it, aren't we?
Unfortunately, all the coastal areas are. It's because, you know, there's a market. That's the problem. The market drives the, you know, what there is. But yes, during lockdown, certainly the Home Secretary put about 20 million nationally into tackling county lines through this National County Lines Coordination Centre that's been set up. And they work with police forces up and down the country to tackle these lines. Mostly it's gangs coming out of London using young people to sell their drugs in areas like Brighton and Hove or coastal seafront areas, wherever there is a market. And then what tends to happen is the young person will come down, say from London, will be put up in a sort of a crack house down here. So they tend to prey on maybe drug users who've got their own property. They'll move in with them, and that young person will then be exploited and used to sell drugs over a few day period and then shipped back to London again. So they often use the rail networks, which is why a lot of the money that nationally has gone into working with British Transport Police as well. So recently in Brighton and Hove in particular last month, British Transport Police were working with Sussex Police, and in 1 week alone, just 1 week, they took £15,000 worth of drugs off the streets. They arrested 29 people, and they made calls on nearly 70 homes of vulnerable people who they thought were being cuckooed, because that's the terminology around it. So, you know, there's a lot of money that drives the drug trade, as we all know.
Cuckooing is a big problem, isn't it? Particularly in Brighton. So it must be quite difficult for victims of that kind of crime to kind of speak out. So
well, very difficult, because they are vulnerable themselves.
Yeah.
They may well be drug users, and that in itself will make them vulnerable. And the gang will exploit them if they've got their own property. They may well move people in, you know, if they've got young people coming down from the city to sell here, they'll let them stay in their property. It's not nice. The young kids get tempted into these county lines gangs by, you know, the offer of money, and certainly during lockdown with a lot of young people on furlough, we've seen that temptation really great. And then once they're in, it's violence and abuse that keeps them in there. They are terrified, and some of the things the gangs do to keep those young people in is quite frightening.
Yeah, and so that's the multi-agency approach is needed there, isn't it? So I guess that's a big focus for the police as well, not just the police, but the other, you know, council and...
Yes. Very much so. Well, very much so. So when they did this this crackdown during September, in this particular week that I spoke of, you know, there was one 16-year-old girl they found at Brighton Station who they had to safeguard. And so, of course, the local council worked closely with the police around that, looking after her. But yes, I mean, she'd come down from Buckinghamshire.
Yeah.
So it just shows you, you know, they're shipped from all over the place to sell the drugs.
Yeah, just before we finish with the first half, tactical enforcement unit.
Yes.
I know we spoke about that. Seems a long time ago now.
Yeah.
But what's the update on that? Because does Brighton have its own?
It does, yes.
Right.
So the new chief has decided that we need three tactical enforcement units, so specialised officers, and their job is to just go after those prolific offenders, the ones that are causing the highest harm, that are doing the most damage in the communities. So we've got one in Brighton and Hove. There's one in the east and west of the county as well. And they've had so many successes. I mean, they've started in December, the first one launched. And since they've all been launched, over just the last sort of 7 or 8 months, they've made over 200 arrests. They've done numerous, you know, hundreds and hundreds of stop searches. And last week alone, the East Sussex Division in one day went to a property and they found more than 430 knives in one property. I mean, it's just, I mean, my drawer in my kitchen has probably 20 knives in it, as most people, but you imagine over 400 in one property. I mean, that's pretty scary stuff.
Yeah.
So these guys are brilliantly trained, in they go, and they've had some great successes. So I'm very excited.
More about that in the second half then. So join us for the second half. We'll be speaking more to Katy Bourne, Police and Crime Commissioner, about crime in Sussex.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
So I'm back here with Katy Bourne for the second half of the vote, talking about Sussex Police. So we're going to, should we just talk a bit about the BLM protests in the centre of the city? We've had about, I think, five protests. I don't think there's any more planned for the rest of the year. Mm-hmm. What's the police approach with the whole Black Lives Matter movement? Because I know that obviously every institution needs to reform and learn. It's a kind of a learning process, isn't it, really, for the police in a lot of ways?
Two parts to that. First of all, people have got the right to protest. So the police's response is as it would always be. You know, they will engage with the protest, and they've got special protest officers who work alongside and make sure the whole event runs smooth so everybody's safe. And I certainly know from the organisers the feedback's been really positive about the police response. But overall, yeah, I mean, this, you know, it's something that the police are very aware of and always need to do more work around how they, you know, tackle BAME communities and how they police them. And it was interesting coming into, you know, the studio just today, speaking to that young woman who was very vocal around how she felt she was being policed as a young black woman. And there's always more that needs to be done. So certainly at a national level, my group of police and crime commissioners, we've set up a working group looking at this. But as far as Sussex Police goes, you know, they do take this quite seriously. There are a lot of internal boards where they do a lot of scrutinising around officers' response, particularly when they do stop and searches and so on. How they conduct those, are they proportionate? They have outside scrutiny bodies, people, members of the public who volunteer their time to come in, and they look at various cases to make sure that those have been properly addressed. Any learning from it is then fed back through, but it is a constant process, and you know they're not perfect by any stretch of imagination.
And most people just want to know they're getting listened to. That's the way it seems to be what comes out, isn't it? You know, I guess if I was stopped and searched, I'd want to know that what's the reason for it.
Well, absolutely, and it's the police have got to have a proportionate. They've got to have the right reason for stopping you in the first place. So you know, if they suspect you're carrying drugs or what have you, you know, there's a whole list, and the form filling that they have to do for every stop and search is quite intense as well. So they can't just do it willy-nilly, but it is on the other hand it is a very powerful tool for the police to have, and it does actually help to disrupt. So if people think about, well, I might go out and carry a knife, if they know they're going to get stopped and potentially searched, they might think twice about it. So it does disrupt that, which is really important. In keeping serious violence off the streets, you know. But again, it is important that the police are very aware, and it has to be proportionate. So in Sussex, they use something called the best use of stop and search. So they will do it to the high standards. But again, in my role, I'm forever scrutinising this and constantly keeping a watch.
Yeah, and it is scrutinised, isn't it? So everyone is, you know, it is. People need to. People are answerable once they get back to the old police station.
They are absolutely. Yeah. So every officer has to be accountable for their decisions around this. But from my point of view, you know, I scrutinise the chief constable on a monthly basis. So we have our performance accountability meetings, their webcast, and it was only a couple of months ago where this was one of the topics that came up, and I spent quite a bit of time talking to her. So you can go on my website and have a look and see the response from the chief constable, and she was very detailed about what the police do behind all of this.
Brilliant. And then on the issue of social distancing, obviously there's a police role there, there's also other agencies are involved. It's got a bit more complicated, isn't it? So what is roughly the Sussex Police's approach to social distancing measures, particularly that there's laws and there's guidelines, isn't there, here? So we're talking about the legal side of things.
Well, the legal side of things, they're pretty much business as usual, as it has been throughout the lockdown. So they have an approach they call the 4 E's approach. So in the first instance, they will engage with the member of the public. They will explain why you've got to socially distance or wear your mask or whatever it is. And then they will engage with them and try and encourage them to go home. Or comply, whichever is the two. And only if that member of the public refuses do they then use the enforcement. But be under no illusions, they will enforce. So they will issue a fixed penalty notice, and of course the fines on those have gone up quite considerably. So yes, that's the approach. I mean, the majority of feedback that we get from the public has been that they are very supportive of the approach that's been adopted to date. So
And I think the opinion polls show that as well, to be fair. So what, with the recruitment drive, obviously there's a big promise for extra police. I do see a lot more police in the centre of the city, Brighton and Hove, where I'm off and about. So two things really. What's the update in the recruitment drive? Was that slowed down during the...
No. Sussex Police carried on. We carried on recruiting. They adapted their training methods. So they went online, did a lot of the training, but they've kept the recruitment up because we've got a lot of officers coming through. So the plan over the next 3.5 years, because we're 6 months into this, was to increase the number of officers by 379. So we're getting 129 from government in their uplift. This is our first tranche from government. We might get more later, but we don't know at the moment. And then locally, local people paying more in their council tax, we're getting 250 that way. So 379 is the ultimate goal at the end of the 3.5 year period. And that will be an increase on what we currently have. So to do that with officers leaving and retiring, you have to therefore, you know, recruit even more. So there's constant recruitment happening. And actually, the Metropolitan Police have actually put a hold on all their recruitment at the moment. So quite a lot of officers or want to be officers who've gone through assessments with the Met are now coming into Sussex as a result. So actually, it's really interesting because about a year ago we were worried because we knew we were going into this recruitment drive. We were concerned that we would be fishing in the same pool as lots of other employers. Who knew that COVID would happen? Yeah. And of course, a lot of people on furlough, and it's made people think, actually, I want a change of career. So we're seeing not just young people coming into Sussex Police. You know, we are seeing older members of the public as well joining. And it's great.
And it is open to everyone, isn't it? Oh, it is. I don't think there's an upper age limit. Well, there is kind of, but it's quite...
Yeah, I mean, I think it's 56 or something off the top of my head. I seem to remember that number. But yeah, because obviously physically you have to be relatively fit and so on. But there's lots of different entry routes in now. You know, you don't have to have a degree to join the police. But if you join the police without one, after 3 years of training, they will give you a degree in policing. So, you know, it's all about really valuing your force. And it's a very exciting time.
And it's a tough job, as we saw from Croydon Police Station. Yeah. Obviously, a policeman based in Sussex tragically lost their life. So it's a tough job being a policeman out there.
Yeah, it was very difficult actually because I was brought up in East Grinstead, so it's my hometown. And I went to the rugby club on Sunday because they did a sort of memorial remembrance kind of moment for Sergeant Ratner. And it was really difficult speaking to people there. There was a lot of strength of feeling around it and really tragic. I think it brings home just how officers do put themselves in the front line. And you have to be on your guard all the time. On average, in Sussex, officers will come under some form of abuse at least twice. We'll have two reports a day in Sussex at the moment. I just think it's unacceptable. You know, that could go anything from somebody being rude to you and, you know, shouting obscenities at you to somebody full-blown attacking you. And we've seen some, you know, we had an officer stabbed just a couple of weeks ago and make, you know, mistakes. The guy intended to kill him. Yeah. Unfortunately, they're going for a slightly lesser plea on that one. But, it's just horrific what's happening. And our new chief constable is very alive to this. And she has said, you know, I will protect you. If you come to work for me, I'll make sure that you're properly looked after.
And post-traumatic stress disorder is quite a major issue, isn't it, amongst policemen? My sister's a paramedic in the ambulance service. So all emergency service workers, I mean, I know the government looking at it, but it might need better protection as well in law.
Well, they're doubling the sentence if you attack an emergency service worker, but they're making it to 2 years. But you know, when I speak to a lot of the public, they say it should be more. It's just not enough. But I think so the sentences need to fit the crime, absolutely. But you know, against an emergency service worker, are people mad? You know, these are people who are putting themselves in harm's way to keep us safe. So what on earth are they doing attacking somebody like that? It's just it's a slightly mixed up world sometimes.
Yeah, it's difficult. Just before we finish up, I know that there's more police in Brighton, so is this a must be
well, I'm glad you're seeing them.
Yeah, it is very
That's always nice to hear. Yeah. But no, I mean, this is all part obviously of the pandemic as well. So visibility in the community, really important. The police are seen. But this is what the public have been telling me that they want. They want more officers, they want to see them out and about in our town, our cities, our villages, and that's exactly hopefully what they are seeing.
Yeah, okay. And people that want to apply for the police force, they just go to the...
They go onto the Sussex Police website and they will be taken through. But very exciting jobs. We've got direct entry detectives as well now. Yeah. You can go in and...
That's a drive from the government, isn't it? So you can enter at a kind of more senior level, which is probably a good thing.
You can.
We need people from all walks of life in the police.
Absolutely. You need a whole mix because you've got to reflect the communities you serve. And we particularly, you know, there's a big drive to try and get more BAME officers as well. So certainly we've seen a real increase in the number of women who are applying, which is fantastic. But we definitely need more from a Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities.
Yeah, and quick word for the rural policing team. I know there's you've got police, you've got kind of civilian people going out on horses as well, haven't you?
We've got the Equine Rangers.
The Equine Rangers,
who are funded through my office. Yes,
last
they're volunteers.
Word on the Equine Rangers.
Yes, fantastic. Yeah. Yeah. And you know, they go out. They're riding anyway, so they're like the eyes and the ears. But it's always the dog walker that will see something suspicious. Yeah. Not usually the police officer.
Yeah.
So the public are the police. At the end of the day, they are the eyes and ears, and it's really important that they're out there supporting the police.
Brilliant. We've run out of time. Thanks for coming, Katy. Cheers.
Pleasure.